Students, in this class we shall discuss a design of a bunker. In the previous video we have seen the theory pertaining to designs of the bunkers and silos, right? In today's class we shall discuss a design of a bunker, right? This is a photograph of a bunker, right? This is how the vertical wall plates of one side and also the vertical wall plates of another side. Actually, this is a rectangular shallow bin of some particular depth, right? 4 meter height, 4 meter height, whereas the length of this bunker is 12 meter, right? And also this bunker, this being very long, 12 meter compared to that of the height, hence will have this divided into n number of equal batteries, right? N number of equal batteries. Now you can see that this entire bin, which is having the upper bottom portion, inclined upper bottom portion at 45 degree, or as appropriate, I'll not say exactly, right? Upper bottom portion, which is having a trap door here, which is also provided with the stiffeners along the inclined direction as well as the horizontal direction for the upper bottom. Even in the transverse direction, the upper bottom is also having the stiffeners along the inclined portion as well as the horizontal portion. Even you please see that this vertical wall is also having the stiffeners, the vertical direction as well as horizontal direction, right? This horizontal, in the horizontal direction, this will avoid the bursting of the plate, as well as the vertical stiffeners will try to keep the horizontal stiffeners in the same position. That is how these stiffeners will try to stiffen, right? This is how what called one panel of the plate, right? Then this entire length may be some 12 meter. In the example problem, we are taking 12 meter, its height is equal to 4 meter, is divided into three batteries. Now, hence, you can see one battery here, the second battery, even third battery is not seen. Hence, there are three spacings for three batteries, which are supported on 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 plus 4, eight number of columns, right? That is how a bunker, which is a rectangular bin, length 12 meter, depth 4 meter, vertical portion, upper bottom portion is around 3 meter or 4 meter as appropriate, right? Is having three batteries. However, we'll design only one battery. We'll design entire 12 by 4, right? And so this entire setup is supported on these columns, n number of columns here, 4 plus 4, eight number of columns, right? Hence, here this upper bottom portion will try to induce a tensile force here. Even the other day we have seen sometimes here I may have at the top horizontal beam, and also along the periphery of this vertical wall plate, at the bottom of this vertical wall plate I may have a girder, a beam, right? However, in this photograph there are no such girders. The stiffeners, they themselves are acting as if the girders, right? We'll discuss a numeric problem with this format. The other day we have seen the product specifications pertaining to this, the top of the bins using IS 4995 1968. Now using that code we shall carry out the designs, right? Unless is followed by the designs as per the IS 800 1984 old version, right? This is a numeric problem. It's a design of a bunker. Design a rectangular steel bunker of 12 meter length and 6 meter width, supported on 8 columns, 4 along each side, to store coal of density gamma or rho 8 kiloton per meter cube, and angle of internal friction pi 35 degrees. Height of the vertical portion is 4 meters, this one, right? And height of the hopper is 4 meters, right? That is all the data given. Hence, that data we are putting here, say L is equal to 12 meters length, length of that bin, length of that bin is equal to this is that length of the bin 12 meters, right? Whose width is equal to 6 meter and whose height is equal to 4 plus 4. That is how the bin. That is how the bin whose length is equal to 12 meter, which is supported on four columns like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 4. Right? Between four columns, there are three batteries are there. This is what called battery of bins. There will be three batteries, right? That is all, right? One battery, second battery, third battery of bins. Third battery of bins, right? These are the geometric arrangement of these, this bunker. The breadth is equal to 6 meter, length 12 meter, and height 4 vertical portion of the vertical plate as well as that of the upper bottom portion. 4 meter in total, it is 8 meter, and number of columns is equal to 8. And material what is given is a coal, therefore, this is a granular material. And from IS 4995, we do have density gamma is equal to 8 kiloton per meter cube, and pi is equal to 35. Even it is already given the problem, the data. If not given, you may always refer back to the coder specifications, and that is how the schematic view, right? There's a vertical wall of 4 meter, right, and upper bottom 4 meter deep. In total, the overall height is equal to 8 meter, starting from top of the cover plate to the bottom of the opening, right? And this is how the width, or a width of 6 meter. Column supports are there on either side. Like this, right? 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, right? Making the number of batteries is equal to 3, right? And I'm assuming an opening of 1 meter square by 1 meter. Hence, leaving that opening 1 meter, I do have from 6 minus 1, I do have 5 meters, which is divided into two parts, 2.5 meters, over a height of 4 meters. That is how the inclined portion, hopper inclined portion. Then the total length is 12 meters, making three batteries. That is the schematic of this bin, which is the bunker, now. And the different forces that will be acting after storing of this material are like this, right? The one is weight in this rectangular portion. Two, the weight in this hopper triangular or part of the pyramidical portion. W3, weight in this rectangular portion, and the reactions on the girder at the top, PH1 and PH3 at the bottom, and reactions on the girder due to the hopper bottom, which is connected to the girder, PH2 and PH4. Right? These are the different forces and reactions. And what is also given, we can also note down from IS 4995 that the pressure ratio for this hole during filling is 0.5, and pressure ratio during emptying is 1. And already in the problem, for the coal angular lateral friction, pi is given as 35 degrees. Hence, from the same IS 4995, I do have the, for granular materials, the angle of friction between the material and the wall is 0.7 multiplied by pi. But pi is already given as 35 degrees, therefore 3/4 of 35 is 26.5 degrees, right? During filling, therefore it is noted as pi prime f for the filling, e for emptying, right? Prime means the friction between the material and the wall, right? That is all. Then similarly, the angle of friction between the material and the wall during emptying is equal to 0.6 multiplied by angle of internal friction pi. Substituting with, now I'll get 21 degrees. And once I get these angle of frictions, then I'll get the coefficient of friction during filling between the material and the wall as tan pi prime f or pi f prime. Substituting with, now I'll get 0.4931. Similarly, during emptying, mu prime e is equal to tan pi prime e. Substituting pi prime e is equal to 0.38, now I'll get 3839. Assuming the size of the opening 1 meter by 1 meter, I already told. Now I'll calculate what are the weights in that first rectangular portion. That rectangular portion is now of height 4 meter, and its width is equal to 2.5 meter. The density of the material is equal to, now I'll get the area, that density I'm having 8 kilometers per meter cube. Now I'll consider 1 meter of the width in the length direction. In the length direction, consider 1 unit width. Therefore, over one meter width, I'll get 8 multiplied by 2.5 multiplied by 4 multiplied by 1 as 80 kiloton per meter actually. Now, similarly, assuming this is my assumption, weight of this bin means because the self weight of the material of the plates and as the accessories has 2 kilotons, I'll get 82. And similarly, the weight of the material stored in upper bottom portion is a triangular portion. Therefore, its area is equal to half base is equal to 2.5 and height is equal to 4 meters. That is how that multiplied by one meter in the perpendicular direction, 1 meter in the perpendicular direction, that multiplied by density, I'll get 40 kilonewtons. And the weight in the small rectangular portion whose width is equal to 0.5. Here the height in the vertical portion is 4 meters, and as well as that of the upper bottom portion is 4 meters. Therefore, 4 plus 4 multiplied by 0.5 is equal to 8. 0.5 multiplied by 8 multiplied by density 8. That now works out 32 kiloton. Then W1, W2, W3 weights because of the storing of the material. Now I'll get the hydraulic mean radius R, which is the ratio of the area of the bin to that of the perimeter of the bin or that of the bunker, right? Now, the area of that bin in total is 12 meter length, right, by 6 meter wide in plan, 12 meter length and 6 meter wide, whereas its peripheral length is equal to 2 12 and 2 6, right? This is the peripheral length. Now, that ratio works out 2 meters. Then I'll calculate this parameter ZOE during emptying, which is R divided by mu prime E KE. Substituting numeric values, I'll get R is equal to 4 and mu prime E 0.3539 multiplied by KE during emptying. The pressure ratio during emptying is equal to 1. R, now I'll get 5.209 during emptying ZOE. Once I get this, now I'll calculate H by ZOE. At a depth of vertical portion, at the end of the vertical portion, 4 meter here, right? Therefore, I'll calculate even at 0 meter as well as at the end of the 4 meters, like that. But there are ones upper bottom will start, right? For it, the end of this vertical portion, 4 meter. What is the H by ZOE? Now it works out 0.768. Then substituting with, I'll get one minus it equals ZOE as 0.536. Then similarly for the during filling, ZOF is equal to R divided by mu prime F KF. R is equal to 2 divided by 0.5 multiplied by 0.4931. Now I'll get 8.113 during filling. R H by ZOF will now work out 4 divided by 8.113 as 0.493. Then 1 minus it equals ZOF will work out 3801, right? Then substituting which, now I'll get what is that horizontal pressure at a depth of 4 meter, starting from the top at a distance of 4 meter during emptying. PH4E during empty. Then we already know that formula W, W R gamma R divided by that ZOE we already calculated, mu prime that. Substituting numeric values, now we'll get 8 multiplied by 2R because radius is equal to 4 divided by 2, WR divided by that mu prime during emptying, 3839. That multiplied by this ratio how to calculate it during emptying ZOE as 0.536, or I'll get that value as 22.34 kilonewton per meter square. Similarly, if I now go to the bottom of the bin, which is at the end of the upper portion, like this upper portion, right? Then at that end of the upper portion, starting from the top, which is at a depth of 8 meter, that point C is a depth of 8 meter, ZOE during emptying, 8 divided by 5.209, it is 1.536, or 1 minus e to power h by ZOE, where h is equal to 8 meter, I'll get 0.785. Substituting which now I'll get horizontal pressure at point C, which is at a depth of 8 meters, as say 8 multiplied by 2 divided by 0.3839 during emptying, 3839, this value multiplied by 0.785, or it is 32.72 kiloton per meter square. Then that is how I'll get a 22.34 at a depth of 4 meter and 32.72 at a depth of 8 meter starting from the reference z is equal to 0. Then now let us see what are the different forces that are acting in the vertical portion as well as that of the upper bottom portion, and what are the forces developed and what are the reactions, right? Now this first free body diagram indicates the pressure force or bursting force acting on the vertical wall, right? The top at z is equal to 0, B is at a depth of h is equal to 4 meters. Later on, upper bottom portion will start. B to C is upper bottom portion, right? BC, right? That this is that portion. Then there, the because of the filling of material inside, I do have the pressure forces acting outside, and so that is what hoop force or bursting force acting outside, which will try to burst the material of the bin, and so that exerts a force PH1 or a pressure, right? PH1, which is acting at a height of this overall height 4 by 3. Therefore, this is a triangular distribution of the load acting at a distance of h by 3. H is now 4 meter. Because of this hoop force PH1, which is caused because of the filling of the material, bursting force or hoop force, I'll get the reactions at the top of the plate. Here at the top of the plate, I do have a girder supporting at the top as well as a girder supporting at the bottom B. At A, B, I have horizontal girders which are running along the periphery, of the bin, which is running along the periphery of the bin. This is how at A, this is how at B, so that entire load will be taken by this girder, right? Which will transfer onto the columns. Vertical loads will be transferred onto the columns, followed by the bending also. Then at the top of that, I do have a horizontal reaction because of this bursting force. Horizontal reaction is offered in the form of reaction at the girder as well as at the bottom, PH3. These two reactions I'll get. And also in the hopper bottom portion also, I do have material stored. Therefore, it will try to exert bursting force, right? Like this. Therefore, bursting force. Then because of that, now the material will try to burst outside. Burst outside, right? And even at the bottom, we do provide stiffeners or small girder Hence, at the point B, I do have a reaction pH2 acting outside, and at the bottom C, also there is a reaction pH4. Therefore, these are the reactions in the girders, in the girders, because of filling up the material in upper bottom portion, like that. Now, let us see this. The bursting force pH1. Now we already calculated this 22.34 at a depth of 4 meters, and also its value at bottom of the upper portion was 32.72. Hence, its intensity is 32.72 kiloton per meter square, and that is of the triangular load. In the vertical portion, it was triangular load. That same triangle is further continuing, which can be split into a rectangular portion having a bursting force of pH2, as well as a triangular portion having another bursting force of pH3. Because this is a trapezoidal variation of the pressure, which is split into rectangular as well as triangular portions, offering the resistance bursting force pH2 and pH3 respectively. Then from the schematic, now I'll move to further analysis. The panel length is now considered as a 4 meter, because the total length is equal to 12 meter, which is split into three panels, right? 4 + 4 + 4, 12 meter. That is our three batteries. Therefore, the panel length is equal to 4 meter. And now the horizontal pressure or bursting force in triangular portion, this pH1, now I'll calculate. The pressure is varying from 0 to 22.34. Average value is equal to that divided by 2, and or a panel length of 4 meters perpendicular plane of the board. Perpendicular plane of the board, 4 meters. Therefore, it now works out 44.68 kN per meter. Similarly, the bursting force in this rectangular portion will now work out, because this 22.34 is a rectangular ordinate of the pressure, or 4 meter. It now works out 89.36 kiloton per meter. Similarly, pH3 in the triangular portion, in the inclined upper bottom portion, the pressure is varying from 0 to this ordinate, where the difference is 32.72 minus 22.34. That much of ordinate is there. That difference plus 0 at the top, its average value, that multiplied by 4. It now works out 20.76 kiloton per meter. Once I get these bursting forces, now I'll do analysis. I'll take some of the movements about point B as a point B. Then I'll get this pH1 multiplied by 4 meter clockwise couple, then P small h1 multiplied by 4/3 in the anti-clockwise direction couple, right? Therefore, equating both of that now I'll get pH1, the reaction at the top of the girder, pH1 is equal to this bursting force divided by 3, or say 14.89 kN per meter. And from the same schematic, I can say, by taking some of the horizontal forces is equal to 0, this P small h1 must be numerically equal to P capital H1 plus P capital H3. But I already know what is PH1, which is just now obtained. When I can calculate what is PH1, only unknown is equal to PH3, doing which now I'll get this result. This PH1 14.89 plus this is unknown PH3, and right hand side PH1 already calculated in the previous step 44.68. Substituting which now I'll get the horizontal reaction at the bottom of vertical plate, or at the intersection of the vertical plate with that of the upper bottom portion. There, the horizontal reaction into the bin, pH3 is equal to 29.78 kiloton per meter. Then, now I'll try to analyze the upper bottom portion, students. And that is how the upper bottom portion is now shown. This is our inclined portion of that upper bottom, which is at the bottom of that vertical, pure vertical portion, right? That is all, right? Therefore, because of the storing of the material, it will be subjected to tension. We'll analyze, right? And the entire material, is having a weight acting in the gravity direction. That is of W1 from this rectangular portion and W2 from this triangular portion, and as well as the W3 from the vertical rectangular portion of height 8 meter. Because of all this, now it will try to bend. Because all these forces are acting, then it will try to bend. Because of that bending, obviously the compressive and tensile stresses are generated. But because it is already connected to the supports at B and C to the girders, then it will have the reactions PH2 outside and PH3 inside, acting inside. Now, then I'll take, let us join this point passing, vertical line passing through B and the horizontal line passing through C. Let both of them meet at O. Then I'll take some of the moments about this point O is equal to zero, right? Then if I do that, taking some of the movements, clockwise couples is equal to anti-clockwise couples, then I do have PH2, right? About this anti-clockwise couple, PH2 multiplied by 4 at a height of 4 meters, then is equal to clockwise couple. About this clockwise couple is equal to W1 multiplied by this width is equal to 2.5 divided by 2 plus W2, that of the triangular portion, W2 multiplied by at a width of two-thirds of this triangle, 2.5 meter wide, and W3 is the rectangular portion, which is at a distance of 2.5 plus 0.5 by 2. Therefore, that is of the couple due to clockwise couples, right? At the same time, I do have the pressures acting in this inclined upper bottom portion, right? PH2 multiple anti-clockwise couple, actually that is bursting force, PH2 multiplied by its height by 2. Height is equal to 4 meter by 2 with minus sign, as well as from the triangular portion, PH3, bursting force, which is triangular, hence at a height of H by 3 with minus sign. Therefore, this is of the stabilizing forces are equal to destabilizing forces. And I already know what are the numeric values of W1, W2, W3, PH2 and PH3. Substituting with only the unknown is the reaction at B, horizontal reaction at the B in the girder at the intersection of the vertical wall plate with that of the inclined upper bottom portion. Now, I'm just substituting to check a result as PH2 is equal to 10.71, because PH2 multiplied by 4 is equal to 80 multiplied by 2.5 by 2, 40 multiplied by 2 by 3, 2.9 plus 32 multiplied by 2.5 plus 0.25 minus 89.36 multiplied by 2 minus 20.76 multiplied by 4 by 3. All these values gives only PH2 as 10.71 kilonewton per meter. Now, similarly, now I'll do some of the movements about point B also equal to zero. Then I'll get what is that PH4? What is that reaction at the bottom of this upper bottom plate, PH4? Therefore, taking some of the movements about point B is equal to zero, I do have PH4 multiplied by 4. PH4 multiplied by 4 anti-clockwise couple equal to sum of the clockwise couples W1. W1 is 80 multiplied by 2.5. W2 is 40 multiplied by 2/3 multiplied by 2/3 of 2.5 plus W3, 32 multiplied by 2.5 plus 0.5 by 2 means 0.25. Now, also about point B, PH2 is clockwise. Therefore, now it is plus. Therefore, that PH2, 89.36, acting at a height of, because it is a rectangular portion, 4 by 2 is 2. As well as the triangular bursting force, PH3, 20.76, is acting at a distance of 2/3 of this height, 4 meters, which now works out 2/3 of 4 meters, substituting all this, now we'll get pH 4, the horizontal reaction at the base, at the bottom of this, bottom of the inclined upper bottom portion, inclined upper bottom portion, like this, inclined upper bottom portion, as pH 4 is equal to 120.81 kilonewton per meter. Now, let us make a statics check whether what we got pH 1, pH 2, all are correct or not. Therefore, let's, for the equilibrium of entire structure, starting from the vertical plates to that of the inclined plates, all the forces, their reactions at the girders, right? pH 1, right, acting this, right, this pH 1 plus pH 3, right, now minus pH 2 plus pH 4 should be numerically equal to these bursting forces, p small h1, p small h2, p small h3, h4, right. Now let us check that I'm doing that. I substituted on the left hand side, I got the result as 154.78. their summation, these results are already obtained in the previous calculations, like this, at pH 4 is 120.81, and we already know what is pH 1 plus pH 2 plus pH 3, bursting forces, all the summation of the bursting forces is equal to the reactions in the girders, altogether 3 girders. Therefore, LHS is also 154.78, HS is also 154.78, means there is no error in our calculations. Means there is no calculation error either in bursting forces nor that of the reactions, pH 1, pH 2, pH 3, pH 4, as appropriate. Right? Now, once the statistic is okay, then I'll move to the further analysis. What are the pressures in the tough wall? Tough wall. There's an inclined upper bottom portion. Inclined upper bottom portion. Then I'll get this like this, that the for the granular materials, we already know from IS 4995, the governing load case is during filling. Therefore, the vertical reactions, vertical pressure PV is equal, given by WR divided by mu prime K multiplied by 1 minus E to power H by Z naught. Right? Then, however, this vertical pressure is maximum if this coefficient is equal to 1 unit. If this coefficient 1 minus E to power H by Z naught is equal to 1 unit, means if E to power H by Z naught is equal to 0, then only this coefficient is equal to 1, then only this pressure is maximum. Therefore, assuming that is equal to 1, then I'll get maximum pressure intensity WR divided by mu prime F KF during filling. Because it's a granular material, the governing load case is for the trough wall during filling. Then I'll get maximum vertical pressure as 64.89. But that point B, which is at a height of 4 meters starting from the top, let me calculate what is that H by ZOF. H is 4 meters and ZOF during the filling is equal to 8.113. We already calculated in the previous headings. Substituting with, now I'll get 493, or 1 minus E to power H by Z0 is equal to 0.389. Then substituting this 1 minus E to power H by Z0 in the above formula, PV is equal to this WR divided by mu prime K, which is the maximum value of 64.89, multiplied by this value, 1 minus E to power Z H by Z0, which is 38.9% or 0.389. Therefore, that multiplied by 64.89, it works out 25.26 kilonewton per meter square. This is from the Janssen's theory. Now, similarly, let us, not going into the Janssen's theory, let us check what is the vertical pressure due to the storing of the material. Just without any knowledge of the Janssen's theory, we can say that the vertical pressure, even if I go to the soil mechanics, at any given depth, the intensity of that soil or the material is equal to density multiplied by that height. Therefore, the density of the petal is equal to 800 per meter cube. And this point B at a height of 4 meter will give rise to a vertical pressure of 32 kilonewton per meter square. But that 32 kilonewton per meter square, which is from the fundamentals without knowing the knowledge of the Johnson's theory. Johnson's theory is saying that vertical pressure at B is 25.26. Therefore, out of these two, whichever is maximum will govern the design. Hence, 32 will govern the design rather than that of the Johnson's theory. Right? Now, at similarly at point C, which is at the bottom of the inclined upper bottom portion, okay, their height is equal to h is equal to 8 meter, small h is equal to 8 meter, h by ZOF is equal to, say, 8 divided by 8.113.986 or 1 minus e to the power h by Z naught 0.627, that multiplied by maximum pressure intensity 64.89 will give rise to 40.68 from Johnson's theory, whereas from just the fundamentals, the vertical pressure at a depth of 8 meter, 8 meter is a density, 8 kiloton per meter cube multiplied by the total depth 8 meter, 64 kiloton per meter square. This is of 64. Therefore, out of these two, whichever is maximum will govern the design. Therefore, 64 will govern the design, not that of the Johnson's theory. And so I'm just recalling those values. That is how 32 is governing the design rather than that of from the Johnson's theory 25.26, which is shown here, the vertical pressure intensity, and as well as at point B, we already got after analysis a force of 22.34 horizontal pressure at B, 22.34, and a vertical pressure. Because of that, what is that analysis reaction we'll see, right? Similarly, at the bottom of this inclined portion, I had at point C horizontal pressure 32.72, and just now I got the vertical pressure 64. That is how these are the 32 kiloton per meter square, 22.2 kiloton per meter square at point B, vertical and horizontal pressures, and at point C 64 and 32.72 vertical and horizontal pressures at point C. And also this upper bottom portion, which is having some thickness of the plate, will also have the weight acting at its CG. Let us say its thickness is equal to T, then the material is having some thickness as well as the density, hence it will have the self weight of that inclined portion of the plate WS acting at the CG at mid length of this inclined portion in the gravity downward direction, which is equal to WS, right? That is all the WS. However, because the material is acting gravitationally in the downward direction, pressure force is acting on the inclined portion like this, but for the bending of the plate, we shall consider the forces in the normal direction, right? Bending moment means due to the normal forces only. Else I'll get the normal forces or normal reactions at the point B, P and B, and as well as at the point C, P and C are the normal pressures at B, P and B, at C, P and C, right? Then the normal reaction at the CG is Rn, right? Normal, right? Similarly, we do have tangential, because its component, this vertical and horizontal reactions can be split into the normal as well as tangential, right? These are the tangential forces at point B and also at point C. Because of that, that material is stored in the inclined portion is leading to bending of this material, leading to the tension of this plate. Because of the tension only, it will transfer the load onto the girder at the intersection of this vertical plate with that of the inclined portion, right? That is how the tension in that inclined upper bottom portion is TB or TC, both are same. Now we'll see, we'll calculate what's the tension at point B is equal to TB, tension at point C is equal to TC. Then the difference is the net tension, right? Let TB and TC are the tensions at points B and C respectively. Then let me calculate this, the normal reaction at the CG of this plate because of the normal pressures PNB and PNC. Then we know that this is varying in a trapezoidal fashion, hence it's average PNB plus PNC divided by 2 over a length of H2 is the vertical height 4 meters. Its length is equal to H2 cosecant alpha, where alpha is the inclination of that upper bottom portion with horizontal is alpha. Therefore, this is H2 cosecant alpha. Then that is how the normal reaction RN passing through the CG. Then what are these normal pressures P and at B and as well as C? We already know the formula from IS 4995R from strength of materials, right? Stresses acting on an oblique section, right? Due to vertical and horizontal pressures, therefore there is a normal force P and PV cos square alpha plus P H sine square alpha plus WS cos alpha, where WS is the self weight of the plate. Now I'll just calculate without the contribution from the self weight later on, but I'll add that contribution also. Therefore, ignoring this, I'll calculate now. Then let us see the geometry is like this. The height H2 is equal to 4 meter and this horizontal distance from B to C is 2.5 meter and the vertical distance from B to C is 4 meter, which is H2. Therefore, the length of this inclined upper bottom portion is square root of 2.5 whole square plus 4 square is equal to 4.717 meters. Therefore, from the figure, we can say cos alpha is the adjacent side 2.5 meter divided by this diagonal length 4.717 meter. And sine opposite is 4 meter divided by 4.717 meters. That is how sine alpha and cos alpha, which can readily be substituted in this formula. And we also know the tangential force PT is given by PV minus PH sine alpha cos alpha plus WS sine alpha. This is because of WS sine alpha is because of the self weight of the plate. Now, let's calculate a normal pressure at B, ignoring the self weight of the plate, upper bottom portion WS, right? Therefore, there PV vertical pressure from this schematic, previous schematic, I do have vertical pressure is equal to 32, right? This value. I'll substitute. Therefore, that is our PV, PH, PV, PH at B and C respectively. Substituting with now, I'll get say 30. This 32 multiplied by this. Cos alpha is 2.5 divided by 4.71 cos square alpha plus horizontal pressure. Horizontal pressure is 22.34 multiplied by sine square alpha. Sine square alpha is 4 divided by 4.717 whole square. At that, no, ignoring self weight of the upper bottom portion WS cos alpha. This within bracket I'm ignoring. Later on, what I'll add. Right? Then summation of these two will now work out 25.05 kiloton per meter square. That much of normal pressure intensity because of horizontal and vertical pressure intensities. I'll get that much of normal pressure intensity. Similarly, at point C, because of the vertical and horizontal pressure intensities like this, right, I'll get normal pressure intensity. Right, normal pressure intensity. I'll calculate that one. Now let me calculate first the tangential force, tangential pressure intensity, which is PV 32 minus PH 22.34 sine alpha cos alpha, or it is 4.34 kiloton per meter square without sulfate contribution. That these are those values, right? 4.34 at B and this 25.05 kiloton per meter square at B. Similarly, you can do the same procedure for calculating at C. Now, it works out like this, right? Therefore, at C, 64, 2.5 divided by 4.71 whole square plus 32.72, 4 divided by 4.71 whole square. It now works out 41.5 kilonewton per meter square is a normal pressure intensity at point C, this point, right? And as well as the tangential force is 64 minus 32.72 multiplied by sine alpha cos alpha, or it now I'll get 14.06 kiloton per meter square at point C. I got a normal and tangential pressures at point B as well as at point C. That using these normal and tangential forces, now I'll get what is that normal reaction at the CG of this plate. By using this formula, PNB plus PNC divided by 2, because PNB is varying, PNB, which was 25.05, is increasing to 41.5. Therefore, average is equal to that divided by 2 over H2 cosecant alpha. H2 is 4, and cosecant alpha is 4.717 divided by 4. That is our cosecant alpha. Or it is now 156.96 kilonewtons is the normal reaction or intensity of the reaction per unit length in the perpendicular plane of the board, right? Then assuming the sulfate of this trough portion, sulfate of this plate WS is equal to 3.6 that of this upper bottom portion, then what is its component in the normal direction, right? There's a WS cos alpha, and as well as the transverse direction, WS sin alpha. So for doing which, now I'll get in the normal direction, I'll get 3.6 2.5 divided to 4.717 or 1.9 kiloton per meter. And in the transverse direction, I'll get 3.05. This is WS sin alpha, 3.05. Then I'll now move to the analysis. Analysis of the trough portion is now over, as well as you analyzed the pressures and design forces in the vertical portion also. Now I'll move to the designs, students. I hope you understood the analysis. Then, if you understood the analysis, rest is the designs. And so now I'll move to design of plate in trough portion. Design of plate in trough portion. Now, assuming the stiffeners are provided at every 600 meter center to center, in both the directions, because here the plate is there for continually for 4 meters, for 12 meters in the length direction as well as in the width direction, right? 6 meter, right? In the depth direction for 4 meter plus 4 meter. Therefore, everywhere I need to provide the stiffness. Otherwise, that hoop force, busting force will try to bust the vertical as well as the upper bottom portion. Hence, we'll assume the stiffness in both the directions at 600 mm center to center or 0.6 meter center to center. Hence, the width of each of the panel is now just only 600 by 600 because after 600, I do have a stiffener here, right? I do have a stiffener both in the vertical direction as well as horizontal direction. Therefore, that is how the panel dimension. Now for the design is only 600 by 600 mm, right? 600 mm square. Out of this 4 meter by this, I'm just taking within the stiffness only, I'm just taking infinitesimally small portion embedded within the stiffness, which is sandwiched between the stiffness. I'm just taking that, which is 0.6 by 0.6 meter only. Panel dimension is 0.6 by 0.6 meter only. Therefore, now, this is my assumption, assuming the thickness of that plate, is 8 mm, right? Then, because of that, that will be bending in both the direction, because I do have the bursting force in the upper bottom portion, right? The upper bottom portion, the bursting force is also there, as well as vertical force is there. Then, that plate is bending in both the directions, right, like this. The plate is bending in both the direction, biaxial bending, biaxial bending. That is of the deflected profile of this deflected profile of the inclined upper bottom portion. Deflected profile, right? There's also shown here, students, you can please see that is of the deflected profile, curvature, right? Curvature over a panel width of 0.6 by 0.6. Therefore, now further, because it's already connected at the bottom point C to a girder or stiffener, as well as it is also connected at the joint B, at joint B to a horizontal beam. Therefore, at both locations, it is rigidly connected. That's my assumption. Hence, the bending moment of this inclined upper bottom portion with that assumption is WL square by 12. With that assumption is WL square by 12. But this is already bending not only in one direction, but also in the other direction, like this. The other direction, right? Both the directions. Therefore, the bending moment is now divided with the two. Now, substituting all these, now I'll get W at that location is equal to 41.5, because this is what it is just now already calculated, 41.5. Because of that, at the end of this plate, it will try to bend both the directions, right? In the both the directions, right? 41.5. Then that 41.5 is a maximum ordinate at a point C. That 41.5 multiplied by this L is equal to now only 0.6 at the bottom of this plate, 0.6 over 0.6 as well as 0.6. Therefore, from end of the C up to a distance of 0.6, right? Panel, right? Therefore, L is now 0.6 only, panel length divided by 12 because of biaxial bending divided by 2. It now works out 0.6225 kilonewton meter per meter width, the perpendicular to the plane of the board, perpendicular plane of the board, right? Now, however, now I'll calculate the actual bending stress, right? Bending compressive or bending tensile stress. It now works out M by Z, but the plate is having a width of B and its thickness is equal to T. Therefore, its width is equal to 600 mm width panel and its thickness is equal to 8 mm. Therefore, BT square by 6 is the section modulus, B is 600 mm, because there the stiffeners are already assumed. After 600 mm, a stiffener is available. Therefore, there is a support, hence panel width B is only, panel width B is 600 mm. That is how the bending of the 600 mm by 600 mm in both the direction. BT square by 6, right? M divided by Z, it now works out. M is equal to 0.6225 kilonewton meter is 10 to the power 6 newton mm, the denominator also in terms of mm. Doing which, now I'll get 97.27 newton per mm square or MPa per unit length perpendicular plane of the board. Okay. There is actual bending compressive or tensile stress, but what is the permissible value as per IS 800, old code 1984, permissible bending or compressive stress, bending or bending compressive or tensile stress is equal to 0.66 Fi. Fi is equal to 250 MPa. Substituting, I'll get 165 MPa is a permissible value, whereas actual is 97.27, much less than permissible. Therefore, the thickness of the plate is okay, or the spacing of the stiffness is okay. Right. Now, let us say if it all this fails, let us say if sigma CT actual calculated is greater than the permissible value, either you decrease the panel width, decrease the panel width and increase the thickness, right? Either of the two is true. Right. Then next one is, now we have seen the design of the main plate in the upper bottom portion. Main plate, which is provided with the stiffeners also like this at every 0.6 in the sloped direction as well as in the horizontal direction. Right? Therefore, now we'll design these stiffeners. Now, that is the design of the stiffeners in trough portion. The bending moment at the midpoint of the trough portion at mid length per unit length. Per meter length or per mm length, right? That now works out the pressure at the top, the pressure at the top, normal pressure, PNB is equal to 25.05 length, right? It's a rectangular portion, W square by 8. Rectangular pressure or rectangular intensity of the load, WL square by 8, L is the length of this upper bottom portion, 4.717 whole square divided by 8, W square by 8 plus that difference, because it is a trapezoidal load varying from 25.05 to 41.5. Therefore, the difference 41.5 minus 25.5 by 2, because there is a triangular pressure distribution, that divided by 2 means average, like W square by 8, W. This is the intensity of the load, assuming the triangular load as equivalent UDL, of this value, 41.5 minus 25.05 divided by 2, equivalent UDL, equal to WL square by 8, right? Then, that gives 92.35 newton meter per meter. Here students have assumed that as divided by 8 for the plate, for the stiffeners, right? Or now it is left to you, because they already provided continually over the stiffeners, this may be assumed as WL square by 12. Then if I divide the 12, I'll get a smaller value, less than 92.35. Therefore, I'm already there on the conservative design, right? 92.35. If you take assuming total fixity, then divide by 12, this is divided by 12, then you'll get less than 92.35. Hence, my designs are conservative now, on the safe side. Hence, that per minimum per unit length, I'll get 92.35 kiloton meter per meter length. But I do have the stiffener at every 0.6 meter, panel width of 0.6 meter. Therefore, for a panel length or panel width of 0.6 meter, how much is the bending moment? That now works out. 92.55 multiplied by 0.6, I'll say 55.53 kiloton meter. Once I get that, this bending moment, which is 55.53, let me calculate what is the tension, direct tension at the midpoint of this stiffener, right? Then that is nothing but the tension at B, which is 4.34, and the tension at C, 14.06, average tension, plus the tension due to the tangential component of the plate contribution, plate WS sine alpha, which is 1.9, right? Therefore, that is how the average plus this contribution from the plate, that multiplied by over a length of 4.717, but I do have a panel width of 0.6 meter. Therefore, the tension over a panel width of 0.6 meter is equal to how much? Now I'll interpolate, therefore I'll get 31.342 kiloton is the tension in the stiffener at the midpoint. Midpoint means at mid length of 4.717 meters, right? Now, once I complete the analysis, now I'll move for the design. Design, that is how the section modulus, because this stiffener is also a bending element, hence the section modulus required is equal to how much? At how much is equal to M. 55.53 kilonewton meter means 10 to the power 6 newton mm divided by permissible bending compressive stress 165.66 Fi. Fi is equal to 250, or it gives 337 centimeter cube, or 337 point into 10 to the power 3 mm cube. Now, what I'll do is I'll increase for the trial section by 50%. Hence, the section modulus required for the trial section is 50% more, or say 507 centimeter cube. Now, I'll propose a built-up section like this using I can propose the sections like this either using Indian standard angles or Indian standard flats or Indian standard T's or Indian standard lightweight beams to resist this bending moment. Now I'm proposing a composite or a built-up section or compound section. That section is now shown, which is built using an INST ISNT, Indian Standard Normal T, whose depth is equal to 250 mm, whose depth is equal to 250 mm, which is at a unit weight of 375 Newton per meter, or roughly 37.5 kg per meter, that is connected to a plate of 320 by 8, because the thickness of the plate is 8 mm, but as per the Indian Standard Code, the maximum width of the plate cannot be greater than 40 times the thickness. Therefore, 40 multiplied by 8 is equal to 320. That is how the plate, it is connected to a plate so that it forms a compound I section, which resembles the schematic. And so these are the properties from the steel tables. Area of this ISNT 250 at 375 Newton per meter is equal to 4775 mm square, and the moment of inertia about the horizontal centroidal axis is equal to 2774.4 mm to the power 4. And for the plate, I do have the area 40 multiplied by 8 is the length of this plate, which is 320 mm, that multiplied by 8. Is 320 multiplied by 8 is equal to 2560 mm square is the area of this plate. And now I'll get the total area of this compound section is area of this T section plus area of this plate section. Summation of these two will give 7335 mm square of this right now. Now, next, what I'll do is I want to get the moment of inertia of this section, hence I'll find out the CG by assuming the top fiber as a reference, which is at the top of the ISNT. Therefore, this is my reference. I've just skipped the steps here. Now I'm saying that y bar is equal to summation of a1 y1 plus a2 y2 divided by a1 plus a2, or summation of at area of this T section multiplied by yt plus area of this plate multiplied by this yp divided by at plus ap, doing which now you'll get a result. From the top, the CG is located at a distance of 130.3 mm, but the total depth is equal to 258 mm. Therefore, now the same centroidal axis of this compound section measured from the bottom will now work out 258 minus 130.3, which is 127. From the bottom it is 127, from the top it is 130.3, that of this compound section. Once again, this CG of this compound section, then out of these two fibers, either 130.3 or 127.3, here 130.3 is the maximum distance. Hence, my longest fiber is at 130.3. Hence, that is what YT in tension, right? 130.3. Then I'll calculate the moment of inertia of this compound section, I capital X capital X or XX, using the parallax theorem, right? Then that is how the moment of inertia of this T section about its own centroidal axis, right, which is concentrated at a distance of 64 mm, plus area of this T section multiplied by H1 square, where H1 is the distance between the CG of this independent T section to CG of this compound section, which is a depth of 130.3 from the top of the fiber, that H1 square. Similarly, that of the plate, moment of inertia of this plate about its own axis B, 320 multiplied by 8 square, BT square divided by 12, that of the rectangle, transferred to the CG, right? As 320 multiplied by 8, 2560 multiplied by H2 square, where H2 is this measured from the bottom fiber 127.5 minus 4, that is H2 square or HP square. Doing which, now I'll get that result as 8792.8 centimeter to the power 4. Now, substituting these, now I'll get the section modulus ZXX is equal to the moment of inertia divided by Y extreme fiber. Extreme fiber distance is equal to 130.3, and moment of inertia is 8792.8 into 10 to the power 4 mm to the power 4. Or this gives 674.8 centimeter cube. But what you are targeting, that is a section modulus furnished, provided, is much greater than the section modulus required 507 centimeter cube. Therefore, the section is okay from bending point of view. Now let us calculate what is the actual bending compressive or tensile stress, which is the ratio of M divided by section modulus. M is 55.53 10 to the power 6 divided by this section modulus furnished 674.8 10 to the power 3. Numerator also 10 to the power 6 Newton mm. The denominator mm to the power 3. Now we get the output as result as approximately 160 Newton per mm square, which is less than the permissible bending compressive tensile stress as 0.66 Fi, which is 165 MPa. Therefore, okay. Means your proposed section is okay from bending point of view. Once I get this, please students, please see that here the in addition to the bending, even I do have the tensile, right? Not only the stiffness subjected to the bending as well as it is subjected to tension, right? Therefore, what is that actual tensile stress in this stiffener is equal to sigma t cap. With the tension we already calculated at the CG of this stiffener plate is 31.4 10 to the power 3 newtons divided by area of this is 7335. This now works out to say around 4.28, very small nominal value compared to the permissible value of 0.6 Fy 150. It is very small, which can be neglected. Hence, okay, actual tensile stress 4.28 MPa is much less than 150 MPa permissible. Therefore, okay, it is okay in both the criteria. Therefore, now that design shall be okay. That proposed section. This proposed section, ISNT. 250 along with a plate, along with the plate of 320 divided by 8 shall be okay. Then once we see this, let us do the stiffness in the other direction also. Right now, that is how the stiffness in design of the stiffness in the transverse directions. Right now, this is the bending moment. Stiffness in the transverse direction. W at the bottom, the normal pressure is equal to 41.5. Assuming the continuity, I'll get W L square by 12. Now, panel width is only 0.6. Therefore, W pressure intensity is 41.5. Width is 0.6 whole square. W L square 0.6 whole square divided by 12. Assuming continuity, right? W L square by 12. But that is bending about both the directions, right? That is how. Divided by 2. This divided by 2 is because of the biaxial bending. That is for 1 meter length. But I do have the stiffness placed at every 0.6 meter. Therefore, now I'll interpolate. Therefore, for 0.6 meter, it is how much? That now works out around 0.3735 kilonewton meter is a bending moment in the transverse directions, in the stiffness, right? And so what is the section modulus required is M divided by sigma BCD permissible bending. Compressive or tensile stress is 165. Dividing this M by this sigma, I'll get 2264 mm cube. This is very small value. Now, what I'll do is, because this being very small, now I'll assume a plate as a stiffener instead of a compound section, a plate or Indian standard flat, ISF, Indian standard flat of thickness 10 mm, right? Either of the two issues like this, flat of thickness 10 mm, right? Then if I assume a flat Indian standard flat of 10 mm thickness, then that section modulus can be equated to BD square by 6. But I do have the thickness D is equal to just now as assumed 10 mm. Therefore, what should be the width, right? Therefore, perpendicular to this plate, right? This is of the stiffener, right? This thickness is equal to 10 mm. Therefore, what should be this width B? That now works out to say B D squared by 6. D is thickness 10 mm square by 6 is equal to 2264 mm to the power 3, equating with now I'll get breadth perpendicular to the perpendicular to the plate, inclined plate, like this. Perpendicular to the plate in the transverse direction, like this, right? This should be 36.85 thickness 10 mm. Now let us say, or say 45 mm. Therefore, provide Indian standard plate ISPL or flat ISF 10 45 ISF 10. 45 is the width of the Indian standard flat and thickness of that flat is equal to 10 mm. Or you may use Indian standard plates also of this size, cut into the appropriate length, right? That is of the design of the upper bottom portion, students. Now let us go to the design of vertical wall, plate, right? Now this we already seen the analysis of the vertical portion, then I'll assume a thickness of this wall plate as 6 mm. That's my assumption. Then the vertical pressure at the bottom of this 4 meter length at point B is vertical pressure is 22.34, right? Therefore, that in the plate, right? Therefore, that W 22.34, now I'll calculate bending moment W 22.34 and length. Even here, we'll assume that the vertical wall plate is also provided by the horizontal stiffness as well as the vertical stiffness, like this, so that my panel length is once again 0.6 by 0.6, only this much, right? Then hence, over a panel size of 0.6 by 0.6, now we get WL square. L is 0.6 whole square divided by 12, but at the same time, it is bending not only in one direction but also in the other direction, that biaxial bending, that divided by 2. Or it now works out 0.3351 kilonewton meter per meter. Therefore, that is for meter length. Now, I'll interpolate over 0.6 meter, that actual bending moment is equal to 0.3351 multiplied by 0.6 m actual is equal to 0.201 kilonewton meter. Therefore, what is the actual bending compressive or tensile stress? Sigma BCT, bending compressive or tensile stress, is bending moment 0.201 10 to the power 6 newton mm divided by section modulus, right? Of this same section B over a width of 600 mm with a thickness of 6 mm square. Therefore, 600 multiplied by 6 square by 6. Now, I'll get 55.83 is the permissive actual bending compressive or tensile stress in the vertical wall due to the bursting and due to the design forces. 59.83 MPa. But which is much less than the permissible value of 185 MPa. Therefore, it is okay. And at the same time, this plate, vertical plate, will also be provided by vertical stiffness as well as the horizontal stiffness, which has spaced at every 0.6 by 0.6, right? Therefore, that vertical plate is having the stiffness like this, And so now let us see the design of vertical plates. The pressure is varying zero at the top, a point B, 22.34 kilonewton per meter square at the bottom. Therefore, now always I'll design for the maximum pressure at the bottom of that plate, the stiffness near joint B, so that the same design can be continued till the top. And so that is how my governing pressure 22.34, and so the maximum bending moment W 22.34 L square L is a 4 meter WL square by 8 that divided by 2 because it's a biaxial bending, right? Then it works out 22.34 kilonewton meter. Now, because the stiffness are there in both the directions, I'm dividing with 2. Yes, that is 22.34. Then, but the section modulus required, is M divided by sigma BCT, permissible. Bending compressor at 10 Celsius, 165. Doing with now you get 22.34 to the power 6 divided by 165. That is the section modulus required. But for the trial section, I'll increase by 50%. Increasing now I'll get 203 centimeter cube, or 203 to the power 3 mm cube. Now, let us try with this section of IS NT 200. In the previous case, you have seen 250. Now this is IS NT 200 at the rate of 284 kiloton per meter, or 28.4 kg per meter, with a plate. Of thickness 6 mm, therefore the width must be 40 multiplied by 6, 240. Therefore, this plate is 240 multiplied by 6. That is how the compound section of the stiffener. Then, that is how the area of this T section from steel tables or from structural handbook number 1 of Indian standards, 3622 mm square, and its area is equal to 5062 mm square, and the area of the plate 40 multiplied by 6. 240 multiplied by 6, which is 1440 mm square. Therefore, you can add both of these areas to get to check the total area, and even you can find out what is that CG of this compound section starting from the top as a reference. Hence, from the top, it now works out y bar is equal to summation of a1 y1 plus a2 y2 divided by a1 plus a2. It gives approximately 99 mm from the top, or from the bottom, it now works out 107, because 200 plus 6, 206 minus 99 is equal to 107 mm measured from the bottom. That is how the CG axis of this compound section passing through the CG of this compound beam. Hence, even now I'll get moment of inertia of this compound section using the parallax theorem as explained in the previous section. Therefore, it now works out IXX is equal to 3273.98 centimeter to the power 4. Therefore, the section modulus Z is equal to the moment of inertia divided by extreme fiber. Out of these, this is extreme 107. Therefore, divided by 107. Now I'll get it. The section modulus Z is 305.98 10 to the power 3 mm cube. Now let us calculate what is the actual bending or bending compressive or tensile stress. Is the bending moment M 22.34, we have already analyzed in the previous subheading 22.34, that divided by this section modulus Z 305.979, or it gives 64 MPa, which is much less than the permissible value of 165 MPa. Hence, the assumed section, compound section, is okay, right? Now, in addition to this horizontal stiffness, even vertical stiffness may also be provided. As we have provided in the inclined upper bottom portion, same section may also be provided, right? Now, next. Let us see, once we complete the vertical wall plate, then I'll move to the designs of the girders, horizontal girders at A, B, and as well as at C, right, at C. I'll recall the reaction at the top of this, what's the reaction? PH, one horizontal reaction in the girder at the top of the vertical plate. At H is equal to 0. We already calculated in analysis, it worked out 14.89 kilonewton per meter length of this length, right? Hence, the bending moment because of this intensity of load, W, 14.89, L square, the transverse direction. In the transverse direction, there are the three batteries, each of 4 meter length, therefore 4 WL square, L is 4 meter, because 4 plus 4 plus 4 is the total length is equal to 12. Therefore, it is split into three batteries, three panels. WL, L is 4 square divided by 8. It works out 29.78 kilonewton meter. Hence, the section modulus required. The 29.78 into 4.6 divided by 165 permissible bending compressive or tensile stress. It is 180.48 10 to the power 3 mm cube. Now, let us try with Indian standard lightweight beam ISLB 225 at a rate of 235 newton per meter, which is furnishing a section modulus of 227.4 centimeter cube, which is greater than 180.48 centimeter cube. Therefore, this ISLB 225 at rate of 235 newton per meter is the final section, final girder section at the point A. I think now similarly you please do the check for the shear as well as check for buckling as well as check for crippling. There's already started graduate level. I'm skipping those checks. Even similarly you may do using the limit state method also, the designs, because the analysis only common here, the design as per the old code using limit state and new code are quite as per those respective codes, right? Now let us see the beam at B, point B, right? There I do have a reaction pH2 acting outside 10.71, right? pH3 acting inside 29.78 from the free body diagram of the schematic, right? I do have the net intensity of the force as 9.07, which is the difference of 29.78 and 10.71. Say 9.07 kiloton per meter is the intensity. Is the intensity, right? Now that 19.07 kiloton per meter. Therefore, that intensity, net pressure, net intensity of the load multiplied by L is 4 meter for each battery. WL square by 8. Actually, it is continuous. Even you may assume by 12, right? Now, actually, that girder is continuous. It may be assumed even WL square by 12, because that girder is supported on a column, on the next column. Hence, it is continuous there also. Truly speaking, it is divided by 12. Then this will now further reduce from 38.14 to a value which is less than 38.14. Right? Then the bending moment M is 38.14. Assuming it to be simply supported, right? Then the section modulus required, M divided by sigma BCT, permissible bending compressive or tensile stress, 165. Doing this calculation, I'll get the section modulus required as 231.15 centimeter cube. Therefore, what now I'll do is I'll provide from the steel tables or structural handbook 1. I'll choose Indian standard lightweight beam 325 at a rate of 431 newton per meter, which furnishes a section modulus of 607.7 centimeter cube, which is greater than 231.15 centimeter cube. Therefore, okay, that is all the design. Right? Now, even the vertical plates may also be provided, right, like this. Therefore, that is how the first stiffener we have designed this inclined upper bottom portion with a thickness of 8 mm. This is that plate which we have designed with inclined 8 mm thick, which is provided with the stiffeners ISNT 200, that section, and as well as in the transverse direction ISF Indian standard flat 45/10 or 45 ISF 10 in the transverse direction, right? Even we have designed this vertical portion of this plate using a thickness of 6 mm, this vertical plate, and the stiffeners as same IS ISNT, right? ISNT 300, and also this vertical stiffness, same vertical stiffness we are providing there, the transverse direction, right? That is how the, you please see that here, these horizontal stiffness are the main stiffness because they are subjected to bursting forces. Therefore, my horizontal stiffness are ISNT 300, the compound section, rather than that of this vertical, right? Vertical are just only that of the Indian standard flats, right? Because there, the vertical portion, the hoop force, bursting force is the major force, right? In the bottom portion, downward force will try to burst. Therefore, there in the downward portion, this vertical is major, right? That is how the stiffness are also shown in the schematic. And even there is a girder here, ISLB at point A, and as well as at the point B, ISLB 325, which is supported over this column, as well as at the right side, right? There is a, the girder is, the beam is continuous over four supports, three span continuous. That is how the design of a bunker, design of a bunker. I hope you understood the design of a bunker. If you like this lecture, please do click like, share and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We'll meet with another topic in the next class. Till then, bye bye students.